Good afternoon to you all. I find myself to be in a different position from my fellow panelists, except from Professor Mujal-Leon, for the simple reason that they're actual practitioners of global governance. And I'm an academic and commentator. That is, I'm a theoretician. As such, my perspective and my opinions come from a different framework. However, like them, I start with facts. In this case, I start not with what we would like, intend, or desire to have, but with what we have now, with two undeniable contemporary facts. First fact, that the world today is increasingly dominated by transnational challenges well beyond the capacity of any single nation state to solve. Second fact, that there is a clear gap between the demand for and the supply of global governments, or in other words, a clear breakdown between the intended ends of most international organizations and the increasingly inadequate means at their disposal. These two facts that are undeniable lead me to what I think are some pertinent questions. First, are these two facts more or less to be expected? My second question, is the second fact, the gap between demand and supply for global governments, an anomaly? And finally, what can we do about both of them? Before answering these three crucial questions, let me quickly first refer some more facts, in this case, historical facts. As an analyst, I think history is fundamental. And these facts that I'm going to mention, these historical facts, show us that in what pertains to global governments, we've already come a long way. From an historical perspective, the achievements made by global governments are huge and truly significant, being a fairly recent phenomenon dated from less than a century ago. Remember that the League of Nations and its subsidiary technical organizations like the World Health Organization and the International Labor Organizations were, in fact, the first global organizations. So in this almost one century, global governance has been responsible by unparalleled sharing flows of information, experiences, funds, ideas, people, goods, technology. It has been responsible by creating economic integration, prosperity and stability, and consequently increasing standards of living in large parts of the world. But most directly, global governments has been responsible for creating and consolidating a significant corpus of universal norms and practices that were virtually non-existent in the several centuries before. And finally, global governance has been responsible for materializing a framework for collective political decision on most global issues. As a result, today, life is a good deal easier, and much of the injustice and brutality of the past is mostly inconceivable and unacceptable at the start of the 21st century. But let me go back to my questions and the corresponding answers. I recall you my my two aforementioned facts. A, that the challenges states face are increasingly transnational, and B, that there's a growing gap between the demand for and the supply of global governments. Are these more or less to be expected? And my answer is a clear yes. We all know that global conditions and problems we encounter today are substantially new, and that and that with that, we face the realities of a rapidly changing world each passing day. What is more interesting, and I would like to underline this, is that nobody, no state or conspiracy has masterminded these profound transformations, nor is in charge of it. My second question and my second answer. As such, is the growing gap between the demand for and the supply of global governments an anomaly? No, it is not. This gap represents the natural and organic reaction of a seven-decade system of global governance, which is under the immense stress and pressure of shifting geopolitics dynamics and profoundly transformative technological revolution. As such, although we must not lose sight of what global governance has achieved to this day, and that I just mentioned, in a certain way, we have to accept that lessons of the past are not so useful anymore. And perhaps that's what's been worrying us so much. In other words, we find ourselves currently in a natural but paradoxical position regarding the institutions of global governments, which I think is well portrayed in the following sentence regarding the most renowned international organization. And I quote the sentence, "The UN is both indispensable and flawed, and we have to know how to live with it." Now, am I saying that we are stuck to live forever with increasingly inefficient global organizations? Of course not. And here enters my third and final question and answers. What can we do and answer? What can we do about it? And here I'm following on Mariana Vanzelaer's footsteps. Simple answers are indeed very, very important. So I'm convinced that we can do a lot, but we can do a lot by starting to do which is more simple. First, we must accept once and for all that the decentralized, fluid, and volatile nature of the current global system is here, and that it is going to continue to change on a daily basis. Second, we must rid the international system of several, in practice, defunct international organizations. I am well aware that politically this is a challenging task. Just to give you some data, so far, from the beginning of the 20th century until now, only 22 international organizations were officially be given as deceased. Only 22. The last one being the Western European Union, that Europeans know well, in 2011. Also, we need to transform our international organizations, mostly by changing their internal rules on reform. And this is fundamental. This is going to be difficult, I know, but the gains from these two proposals, both financial and in governance efficiency, are obviously significant. Third, it is my opinion that we need a new multilateralism for the future. I know it sounds like an empty slogan, new multilateralism for the future. But what I'm asking for is not a radical change, not a radically new multilateralism, less so an idealistic one. For instance, I'm of the opinion that we do not need a world government. As a matter of fact, I find the idea of a world government in charge of world governance according to a given idea of what constitutes a good life not only inherently undesirable, but dangerous too. Instead, I'm a partisan of a networking of international organizations built from existing functional organizations, a networking that should be built in a progressive way through pragmatism, i.e., the real knowledge, based in the real knowledge of the possibilities and limitations of those existing organizations, but also based on creativity. After all, we are facing uncharted waters. Finally, this networking of global governance should have multiple layers of governments: global, regional, transnational, national, and local. And because my time is ending, let me just very briefly pinpoint two of these layers. The transnational layer, NGOs, I think, are increasingly important and in most cases doing a wonderful work, but they have to cooperate closely as equal partners in the same foot with intergovernmental organizations. For example, at the time the UN was founded, around 20 NGOs started working with the organizations. Nowadays, 3,287 NGOs are registered partners with the UN. These are numbers from today morning on the website of the UN. National level. States will continue to be a fundamental element of global governments. I know this is not acceptable for some of you, but this is my opinion. I think that states are indispensable in global governance. And why? Mostly because, after all, it is at the national level that we find the strongest source of allegiance, but also the true sources of democratic legitimacy. Without states, international cooperation, global governance, would only be inconsequential and mostly politically unaccountable. This is my personal view, and as such, is very debatable, and I'm very much willing to debate it with you after the discussion with the panel. I began my comments with two undeniable facts. I conclude now with a further undeniable and very simple fact, that in the 21st century, global governance will surely play a greater role than it ever had in history. Thank you so much.